Hello students, as a part of Digital Education Initiative of Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam Technical University, here is another lecture in the series, lecture series of subject VLSI Technology. Since we have studied all the unit processes, we are coming to the back end process, like ending up, like termination of the, like finalization of the IC. And since we have already studied the metal contacts and how to establish the metal layer or how to deposit the metal layer, the processes which are used in depositing the metal layer, different choices of materials which are being used to form the interconnects as well as the contacts, we are going to see the final thing, that is role of chemical mechanical polishing and what are the challenges associated with the metallization and their remedial actions or remedial strategies which are adopted to overcome these challenges. As a student, at the end of this lecture, I expect you to narrate the issues related to metallization and remedial actions to prevent those issues. I expect you to describe the overall process of chemical mechanical polishing and how it is different. Like, you should be able to relate this particular process, the role of this process, and the process what we were using in the wafer polishing. So it is similar kind of process but with different aim. So you should be able to understand that what exactly happens. Now, why do you need planarization? Now, planarization is the technique. Now, you know already when you start or at the beginning when the wafer is considered for fabrication, the wafer surface is flat, uniform. But in due course, when different processes are being organized or are being carried out, during that, like you have epitaxial growth process, you have diffusion, you have ion implantation, you have thin film deposition, oxidation, different processes, etching, different processes when are being carried out, different like cleaning processes, intermittent, which are being done. So during those processes, there is every possibility that the layer which is getting deposited may not be uniform, and therefore you have to consider the planarization under two heads. One is known as local planarization and one is known as global planarization. Now, what do you mean by planarization? Planarization is basically making the surface even so that the next step, that is whatever next thing is happening, that should be having uniform surface finish, or that should be properly done up. So during metallization, planarization is one of the important thing which is eliminating the unwanted layer and making the overall surface of the wafer, which is already diffusion area and other things incorporated, in the linear form or in the proper what you call flat surface. Like you want the end result to be perfectly flat so that there is no dangling bonds left or some like scope for further degradation as far as your electromagnetic other things, like whatever, like when the conductivity is happening through the wafer. Now, this is being shown when you are depositing the oxide also, there is unevenness being observed over here. Now, these unevenness is not recommended in the end product. And therefore, we need local planarization. Local planarization is just filling up these local gaps. Whereas, in case of my global planarization, I go for filling up these gaps with oxide layer through and through, that is here. So, this is called as local planarization, where only local unevenness between different area is being addressed, whereas global planarization is overall wafer surface is being taken into consideration and overall wafer flatness or surface flatness is taken into account. Now, to address this or to reach out to this particular global planarization as well as local planarization, global planarization, basically we go for chemical mechanical polishing, and this is the same machine what we were using in the wafer polishing. So, whatever we were using for wafer polishing, same machine is being used. You have the rotating chunk which is there is a lot of theory gone into the rotational speed, the pressure at which it is to be done, and this is the slurry which is used to create provide proper friction to eliminate the layer, like very fine layer will be eliminated and the surface will be made smooth. And this is what is exactly being done. You have the wafer carrier and the wafer is being held up with the vacuum system, and firmly it is being held at a proper angle, or like which is perfectly placed at the right, exactly right angle. You have a slurry supply happening over here. The slurry is used to create the adequate friction so that your wafer is continuously, this is how your wafer is getting rotational, okay, movement of that particular pad, polishing pad, and your wafer is continuously, or the particular portion is removed so that you get the perfect flat surface on the wafer. Now, what exactly is the equation which is going on? Please remember, this chemical polishing or chemical mechanical polishing is a very precision, what you call, method, or it is to be performed at a great precision, and lot of mathematics has gone into defining that. So it depends upon the material which is to be planarized, and depending upon that, even though it is basically a chemical mechanical, essentially a mechanical in nature, the microscopic action of polishing, both chemical and mechanical, the rate, removal rate, is given by something known as Preston equation. And that Preston equation is R is equal to Kp into V, where Kp is the proportionality constant depending upon the mechanical properties of the material that is to be polished or that is to be eliminated, the polishing pads as well as the polishing slurry, that is in the properties of the slurries also, slurry also comes into picture over here. And P is the applied pressure and V is the relative velocity between wafer and the polishing pad. So please remember, the pressure, the velocity, okay, the constant, proportionality constant, which is proportional or which depends upon the material to be removed, slurry, the property of the slurry, similarly the velocity at which it is to be rotated, that pad is to be rotated, and the pressure with which the pad is to be to be applied during the polishing. So all these things are very, very precisely controlled when we are going for this CMP. Now, what exactly happens in this CMP? There are four basic reactions happening. First is formation of hydrogen bonds with the oxide surfaces of both wafer and slurry particles, and we call it as hydrosilation. That means basically it's the reaction where you have something known as CH bond getting oxidized into COH bond. Okay, then you have second reaction which is indicated over here, and that reaction is basically formation of hydrogen bonds between wafer and the slurry. The third reaction is basically formation of molecular bonds between wafer and slurry. See, wafer and slurry, these molecular bonds are being formed. And the fourth one is breaking of the oxide bonds with the wafer or with the slurry when the slurry particle moves away. When the slurry particle moves away, these bonds are broken and thereby the entire, okay, the surface is eliminated along with the slurry. So slurry is basically taking away the unwanted portion, making the unevenness, okay, make or converting that unevenness into a smooth finish. Now this CMP or chemical mechanical process actually is a complex thing. You need to ensure that there is no damage in the surface layer, because the microscopic nature of CMP distinguishes it from the mechanical abrasion. So there are no mechanical abrasion. This removal should be precisely to be done. The mechanism is very less understood basically, because it is very complex as compared to your normal wafer polishing. It is difficult to detect the end point, because you need to precisely, I told you already, it is to be removed very precisely. And you cannot decide, or there is very difficult, that to what extent you need to remove that particular portion. And for that reason, simultaneously there are either electrical property, what you call measuring instrumentation systems being incorporated, or there may be optical instrumentation systems being incorporated like ellipsometer or Raman spectrography or some other microscopic observation viewpoints, or some probes will be connected over there, so that the moment you get precise property or electrical property or optical property from that material, like capacitance either you will measure or resistance you will measure, the moment you get precise property as you are expected to attain, this chemical mechanical polishing is stopped. So endpoint detection or the termination of this, or where to stop, when to stop, at what extent you need to stop, how much layer you need to remove, that is decided based on continuous measurement. So promptly the properties are measured, and based on that, once you attain the properties, automatically it will be stopped. So how it is being done? This is being indicated. It's very complex. I told you this is the process, or this is the unevenness which is being observed. This is the mechanism of metal CMP which is being shown. Now this free metal surface is covered by a passivation oxide. Now what is being done is, please remember, oxide here, what is being done? The oxide on the high spots is removed by CMP and metal is etched by the solution. Now here, please understand, this is being removed by the polishing and the metal is removed by the etching. The process, okay, the regrowth of, then you carry out the regrowth of, see, first you try to regrow this and then you carry out this, you remove and regrow the, here you are having the regrowth. Now you regrow the oxide and you repeat, keep on repeating this. So you remove, regrow, remove, regrow, and ensure that you get proper, this is how your planarization is attained over here. Instead, this unevenness is eliminated and you get perfect plane surface, you get planarized surface. So you have perfect plane or perfect surface what you are going to get out of this. As we know that once we get the planarized surface, we have seen in during metallization that till 1970s aluminium was the most preferred material, and the choice of aluminium was due to its low resistivity, adhesion with silicon as well as silicon dioxide. It can reduce other oxides and it can be very easily etched as well as deposited. So basically whatever properties are expected from the metallization material which are to be used for metallization, all those properties were being exhibited, and therefore aluminium was most recommended choice till 1970s. But there were some problems or issues related to aluminium which were observed over a period of time, that is relatively low melting point, and therefore it was unsuitable for gate electrode and local interconnect because of the soft properties, like it being a soft material. And since it's a soft material and it has got property to dissolve in silicon, it has a tendency to form spikes. Now these spikes, like because of the oxide, see, because of the dissolving into oxide, what was happening is there were formation of you were having spikes because it was easily getting diffused into the silicon, and there were formation of spikes. Now these spikes were basically getting entered into the low level which is below that desired level, and there were unprecedented or undesirable consequences which were creating unnecessary interconnects or thereby compromising the reliability of the device. Another issue which was being observed was the formation of hillocks. Now what is this hillock? Just see, here you are having silicon dioxide layer. The silicon being amorphous in nature, the grain boundaries are uneven, and any stress which is created when the AL film or aluminium film is being laid down, the stresses which are involved can create hillocks because of the grains, like whatever grain boundaries were there, they were uneven. And the stress when the film was having some stresses, or the grains were having whatever amorphous layer was being formed, those grains were getting uneven into nature, and that was resulting into aluminium hillocks. Now these hillocks were equally dangerous or all like compromising the reliability of the device, and therefore to overcome this there was an issue, or there was a this thing was being addressed by adding few percent of copper, because this copper addition was stabilizing the grain boundaries, and that was basically reducing the stress level and hillock formation. There is another problem which was being observed during the metallization when aluminium was being used. Since it's a polycrystalline material and many monocrystalline grains are there, we have seen the grain boundaries, and under stress they were creating hillocks. So when current was flowing through this metallization layer or through this interconnect, the electrons continuously getting bombarded at these grain boundaries, and because of these small grains, like whatever the grain boundaries which were very small, like you have multi polycrystalline nature, and that result, like when they were these grain boundaries were moving from like two molecules, like when they were moving from, like suppose this was the thing, the grain boundary was getting wiped off and this particular thing was getting added into it. So this is how the grain boundaries were moving, and this effect was called as electromigration. So actual material which is deposited, that area or that particular connectivity was getting disturbed, or because the grain boundaries were continuously getting connected, or grain boundaries were shifting because of bombardment of electrons through the interconnect when the high current, like high density current, was flowing through those interconnects. Now this became very prominent when after 1970s this what you call the vias or the interconnects were like the device dimensions got reduced, and the scaling of the interconnects and contact vias were also getting shrunk, or they were also reduced, their dimensions were reduced. The current density was high, and sometimes it was higher than, like through vias. What are these vias? Vias are nothing but the metal interconnects, whatever you are having, those metal interconnects when they are connected through each other. So now this is for suppose metal layer 1, you have other isolation layer, and you have something known as metal layer 2. Now the interconnect between these two metal layers when formed, we call that as a via. Okay, that is called as via. So now these vias were also, like since there was multi-level metallization being done, this metallization or these vias were also becoming very small, and the current density through these was much higher as compared to the metal conductors. Now in practice, this particular electromigration was observed because of two major reasons. One was poor metal step coverage, and vias which were carrying high current, like current density through these flow of the current which was flowing through vias was much larger. Second was different materials were being used for vias, such as we were using this plug was being made up of tungsten rather than aluminium. It was made up of tungsten to give the give rise to the localized current, and thereby like there was crowding of the charge carriers that was increasing the current density, and because of that also this electromigration problem was becoming very very prominent. So to overcome this, what was being done? So prior to that, let us see what are the consequences of it. The consequences of this particular metal electromigration was they were tearing apart the metal lines. The metal lines were getting discontinued. High current density was remaining in the line. There was aggressive electron bombardment, and that was further degrading the grain migration, or that was further enhancing the grain migration, and further electromigration was happening that eventually was breaking the continuity of the interconnect. The metal line was getting broken, there was discontinuity, and that was in turn hampering the overall reliability of the integrated circuit. So overall chip functionality was getting compromised because of this electromigration. So what was the remedy behind of that? So first remedy is, rather than using the tungsten plug when you are interconnecting the multiple layers of metals, we were using the same kind of like alloy of aluminium or you like you were using or some plug with aluminium into it, like some combination of metal which was having aluminium into it, so that there is continuity of the aluminium flux between the interconnect as well as, suppose you are having one line of interconnect over here and this is another metallization. So these are the wires which you are connecting one layer of metallization to the other layer, and this was being done using this was like same material, like some material which was generally, this was done using tungsten. So here also, instead of tungsten, they started using aluminium alloy. Secondly, the current density was also reduced through this corner of the wires. So by applying, how it was attained? By applying the titanium nitride layer between the plug, which is tungsten plug, and the aluminium metallization interconnect wire. The current overcrowding of the inner corner was also reduced, as TIN with higher electrical resistance was helping to distribute the current from via to a wider area as compared in the aluminium wire. So basically, this plug which was being used, it was distributing the, like you were using. So how it was being used, just see, this was the step coverage, poor step coverage it is being shown. So this can current, okay, this can cause current crowding and this can cause electromigration. Second was plug contacts cause voiding, okay, and AL plug, this was the interface where you were not able to have proper connectivity and the current crowding was happening. So current crowding was also happening in the inner corner of AI plug contact. So instead of that, what we have done, we have connected, or here we have layered TIN, that is titanium nitride layer was being deposited over here. Now this layer was, since it is having high, like better properties or electrical properties because of the higher resistivity, it was basically changing the crowding effect and thereby reducing the electromigration. Metal corrosion was another issue. As the aluminium grows, passivation oxide in air, it is naturally protected against the corrosion. However, in order to increase the electromigration resistance, aluminium wiring was used in the integrated circuit, was containing copper which has no passivating oxide. That is, we were using combination of copper. So AL copper, like aluminium copper alloy, was being used, and that was vulnerable to corrosion because of the inherent properties of copper. The corrosion of aluminium wires was basically because of the four sources. One was chlorine transported through the plastic packaging and the passivation materials. Second was phosphoric acid removed from excess of phosphorus or phosphosilicate glass, that is PSG. Chlorine, which was being used as the agent, like two main contaminants were there. One was chlorine, which was transported in the plastic packages, or that was used for the agent, as an agent, like part of agent. Second contaminant was phosphoric acid, which was formed because from the excess of phosphorus in the phosphosilicate glass, or galvanic erosion was happening because of the electrochemical action, because of the dissimilar materials, because there were different materials which are dissimilar in nature, there was electrochemical or galvanic corrosion happening. Now what are the remedies for that? Since most chemicals used for aluminium etching or RIE, that is reactive ion beam etching, were containing chlorine, AlCl3, that is aluminium chloride or similar compounds are formed, and aluminium surface afterwards and upon exposure to moisture in air, there was tendency to get corrosion, like encounter corrosion, or it was getting corroded. So for that reason, there was careful cleaning was necessary after the etching, that is complete removal of the residues of the etching where was essentially being done. And once that was being removed, with regard to corrosion, due to like the chlorine possibility was completely eliminated. Second was because of the phosphosilicate glass, average phosphorus content in the PSG was not to be high, that it was maintained at a constant rate, and it was maintained well below 6%. So phosphorus content was reduced, so automatically there was no phosphoric acid getting formed, and the amount of like corrosion because of the phosphoric acid was being eliminated. The reflow temperature can also be lowered by adding few percent of boron to phosphosilicate glass. Metal corrosion, another remedies include, like since you have modern materials have got multi-layer metallization, dissimilar metals such as a TI, that is titanium, titanium nitride, aluminium with copper, then other like dissimilar metals are being used, so that the possibility you have more chances of corrosion. So basically we try to avoid that, like we try to maintain lower temperature. Copper is electropositive relative to hydrogen and is not vulnerable to electrochemical corrosion. However, when it is exposed to copper oxide grows linearly when it is exposed to in air, copper oxide grows linearly with time, indicating lack of protective layer. So copper metallization, whenever is done, you need to have protective layer, as shown over here. You have TI, that is, you have here, you are having aluminium, it is enclosed with TI, that is, you are having barrier of titanium. Similarly, here also you have AL film, you are using, so these are hillocking form, because so you ensure that you have a barrier layer which is being considered. Now similarly, I told you, in shunting, aluminium helps to mitigate the electromigration and can provide mechanical strength also, because it has got very good adhesivity, property of adhesivity, and barriers in the multi-level metallization can prevent this electromigration and spike formation or hillock formation, and thereby this multi-layer metallization can be very, very useful. If you use aluminium, aluminium copper combination is used as metallization layer. This is metal layer 1, this is metal layer 2, but there is a barrier of titanium in between. Similarly, here also you will see there is barrier. You have glass, or you have SOG, which is being used with plasma enhanced CVD. You carry out bilayer on the formation, like passivation of bilayer is being on the top of the final metal level, you carry out. And once you protect that final metal level, the corrosion will be prevented. And in between also, you are having tungsten plugs, you are having metal 1, metal 2. So you try to isolate these metal layers one after the other. So by multi-level metallization isolation, providing different materials which are being used to enhance the property, or avoid the electromigration, adding preventing proper chemical elimination of the agent through proper cleaning, or reducing the content of phosphorus in the PSG. So these are the basic techniques through which you can eliminate the corrosion. Now at the end, to check out whether you have understood or not, try to attempt these particular questions. Find out, you try to answer, what are the common problems in aluminium metal, why it is not being used as a gate, as the interconnect or in the gate material, what are the remedies, that is, you need to answer how it forms spikes, how it forms hillocks, what are the grain bound, how the movement of grain boundary happens, then describe the electromigration, corrosion issues encountered in metallization and their remedies. You should be able to process of metallization, you should be able to explain with neat schematic of the entire thing. So if metallization is clear, then we will proceed further with next stage, that is assembly and packaging of this chip. So thank you, good luck, and God bless.